Sorry if I'm repeating myself, but in 2004, when Turkey was about to start its accession negotiations with EU, there was the December summit where the decisions were taken and the first chapter was going to be opened. I remember the list of media following that particular summit, Turkey-EU summit, and proportionally there were more journalists from non-EU and non-Turkish countries following that particular summit. It tells us a lot. That means that the Turkish-EU relationship is really, you know, I mean, being followed very importantly, very, you know, closely by the other parts of the world. Because if it succeeds, it means more than just a normal sort of integration. Turkey being a predominantly Muslim population, the Muslim population, and Europe, of course, I mean, coming from different cultures and religions, but if these two can integrate with each other on the basis of certain values, standards, and interests, it is a source of hope for everyone. I think that's what you meant, really. I mean, if Turkish-EU relationship can go forward in a win-win sort of way, then I think Iran will also be more, incentivized in that regard to have this relationship with the EU. But unfortunately, there, I mean, since 2004, there, of course, I mean, there was a huge interest. And Turkey also, we were quite hopeful that this relationship is going to work for the benefit of both sides as well. But now, after 12 years, unfortunately, there's not much we can show out of this process. And that's mainly due to the lack of vision. That's really, I mean, maybe we are just lost in small details here and there, whether it's political, economic, or otherwise, but we are really, you know, I mean, losing the big picture, what it means for both. And I think many of the problems that we see around ourselves in North Africa, in Middle East, and elsewhere as well, is also related to that. It's not only because, I mean, Turkey is not yet a member of the EU that we see these problems, but the way EU, you know, I mean, addresses the countries in its neighborhood and what they can do together rather than separately, I think is really very, very carefully read by all the other countries. Those who are on the recipient side or those who are trying to undermine this relationship, like in the case of Russia, for example. So I think we need to look at this sort of relationship, be it Georgia-EU relationship or be it Turkey-EU, you know, sort of processes in a larger, in a more strategic way, and need to do more about that. And it's not only Iran who's going to draw the lessons from that. I think both in North Africa, in Middle East, and in Russia, in general, wider Black Sea region, there are many countries, there are many groups who are really looking forward to get the right lessons out of this relationship.
Excellent. Nazar, that argument has been our argument as well. When we speak about Georgia's NATO integration, it's not about Georgia and NATO, but we see more wider players in the region. So when we speak about the European Union, especially the economic opportunity that has been opened with the DCFTA agreement, and while of having Turkey as a key economic partner and trade partner. And Turkish economy is largely very much technologically advanced rather than the economy, agriculture, all these things, rather than Georgia. How you would see the potential of attracting this knowledge and technology from the Georgian economy as a multiplying factor of utilizing DCFTA for the European Union?
First of all, Georgia being having now signed the CFTA is a very good target point for investors who would like to work with Europe, obviously. As such, I think we can easily attract investors willing to produce for European markets, including investors from Turkey. Another important thing is that Turkey now, as far as I know, is making extensive innovations on information technologies, which means that some part of Turkish production lines, which are less popular than Turkey itself, can be transferred to Georgia, and they are being transferred in some way. So that's another economic potential we can see. Also, just the fact that we have as a neighbor and an important partner country, technologically much more advanced, and as I said, we need to produce this technological and information technology advances as they have. We can use just security storage spillovers as such, and it would be a very good opportunity to have our technology improved through our relationships, through cooperation with Turkey. So I think at the end of the day, Georgia should make accent on culture, on industry, and in this aspect we can actually use the example of Turkey, who very successfully made transition from basically an agrarian country some 80 years ago to a technological, well, I would say giant, because Turkey has any kind of technology industry, from TVs and washing machines to vehicles, etc. So I think apart from current cooperation, we can just use the example how Turkey made this transition. And I think the important thing in actually reforming the country is to take in good examples, using the good example. We cannot take recipe as it is and just do what Turkey did, but at least we can think about what lessons did Turkey go through, how they did reform their own society, their own economy, and actually take the best practices they have used. So I think that's very important on two levels. One, we can attract Turkish investors and attract investors from many other countries who want to trade with Europe, because we can enjoy now this CFTA status. And another thing, in particular in relation with Turkey, we can use the experience, the very good experience that Turkey have had from transition from agrarian to highly industrialized and now post-industrialized country.
Thank you. Before turning to the audience and there will be questions as well from the audience, I would like to ask one question to both of you. Besides, of course, strategic opportunities that are opening right now with the new changing environment in Europe and globally as well, as our region, the Black Sea region, being in the center of these changes, when you read in the communique, there is a discussion of Baltic Sea, Black Sea, and Mediterranean Sea. And we are in the middle, of course, Turkey plays quite a greater role. Georgia has its own function as well. And one of the most important element or most important factor that could maximize the effect of our potential strategic value for the democratic civilized world is the democratic credentials. And we all have our own domestic problems with regard to this. So how you could see our bilateral cooperation as a platform for improving our democratic image, or as your ambassador said in the beginning, constantly improving our democratic credentials to give more weight or more value of our strategic role and function.
That's also, I mean, very important. Let me tell you this, for example, I mean, from our own experience, if it's about shared experience, the times when we made the most democratic advances is the times when we had this very good prospects of EU membership, and where this membership process really was really pushing us in a certain direction. And also when we felt safe and sound in terms of our environments, you know, in terms of our external environment. So, of course, I mean, democracy is something that needs to be owned by the people, and it has to be, of course, a natural sort of evolution of itself based on the expectations and aspirations of the population itself. But it's also very much related, let's face it, I mean, the pace of democratization is also very much related to economic and foreign policy and security environment as well. And in that regard, I think both of us, I mean, the more we support each other economically, the more we support each other in terms of the security and foreign policy issues, and the more we can feel, you know, I mean, more stable and secure in this part of the world because of this relationship, I think that's also going to definitely impact our democratization process as well. Of course, we can always share experiences as to our own democratic experiences, what went wrong and what is the best practices. And I think there's also a lot to to you know, do that. Because I mean, after all, Turkey, the modern Turkish Republic has been founded only in 1923. And I'm saying only in 1923. In terms of the democratic, you know, I mean, evolution of a country, I think we're still in the maybe early stages of that. We're still trying to find the best means as to make, as to consolidate our democracy and as to make it a very solid, sustaining sort of process for ourselves. But for Georgia, of course, it is much less than that. It's only 25 years. So I think there is a lot that we can, you know, I mean, share as two emerging democracies. What are the challenges? What are the obstacles? And what are the, you know, I mean, benefits of this process? But I think, you know, I mean, that also, you know, I mean, what I said in the beginning. I think our economic cooperation, the sort of integration that we are seeing between Turkey and Europe, is probably going to make Georgia much safer and much more confident in itself. And that's going to make Georgian political leadership take certain bold steps in a much easier, in a much more comfortable way as well. But of course, when it comes to foreign security environment, that goes without saying. Although Turkey and Georgia, that is important, our cooperation, but it's not enough. Turkey is of course a very important regional country, but we are not powerful alone to steer the developments in the right direction. We need partners, we need allies. That's why, I mean, for example, we see Georgia's relationship with NATO and Georgia's, you know, I mean, eventual membership to NATO as a very important contribution to the security of this particular region. So, I mean, if we, you know, continue making progress in that regard, I think that's also going to be very important for our own democratization processes.
Excellent. Thank you.
Just a couple of words again from the
position
of an economist. I think, first of all, democracy is something kind of for the people. So I think the important bit is to actually persuade people that the current democracy is the best way of ruling that we have now. And the best way to do it through is actually showing the economic positive sides of democracy. We actually must show that when we are a democracy, we have actually larger GDP, we have larger growth. We go much more faster, we go forward, and we can do it through cooperation with Turkey, we can do it through cooperation with other democratic countries, we can, again, security, of course, is a very important part of the democratization process, but finally, at the end of the day, we must persuade people that democracy is the only choice we have. If we want to be a developed country, if we want to be an economically strong country, we need democracy. And I think that one of the important, maybe not the most, but one of the very important parts of it is the activities of think tanks like EPRC and others. We can actually prove through our research, through our you know, policy briefs or whatever, that you know, democracy is the only way. That if we want to have higher GDP, if we want to have a good economy, if we want to have a technologically economically developed society, we need democracy. And I think that's our role.
I mean, maybe I forgot, I put it in the wrong way. I said, I mean, the advances we've made in our democratization process was at times when we had this, you know, prospects, stronger prospects with the EU and such. But vice versa is true as well. I mean, when our economy is doing well, you know, I mean, our democracy is doing good, but when our democracy is doing well, we're also doing much better economy. That's the time when we started, you know, I mean, attracting foreign direct investment, because Turkey became a country, you know, based on rule of law, accountability and such. So people, I mean, foreign direct investment started coming to Turkey much easily. And also the Turkish entrepreneurs also started realizing their potential in a democratic environment where they are free for entrepreneurship, where they are free to express their minds and such. So this goes hand in hand with each other, definitely. And I think, you know, the international cooperation as such is also very important.
Excellent. Thank you.